Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome. It's now time for the featured bout of the evening. From the four corners of the world, to the four corners of this ring, the fight starts now!
San Antonio, Texas, rich with American and Mexican history and tradition, and now home to boxing's youngest champion. Tonight, 22-year-old Jesse Bam Rodriguez makes his first WBC title defense in his hometown in the brand new Techport Arena. Is the site for his toughest opponent to date in pound-for-pound legend, Sisaket Sor Rungvisai. Good evening, everybody. Welcome into San Antonio, Texas. I'm Justin Shackle, getting you set on Before the Bell. The former junior welterweight champion of the world, Chris Algieri, and Austin Ammo Williams will be joining me in a few moments. Ammo making his first fight commentary debut here in San Antonio. Later tonight on DAZN, you're going to see Jesse Bam Rodriguez, and it will not be any type of soft victory tour for the 22-year-old. Following his February 5th title win over Carlos Quadras, Bam Rodriguez is set to make his first WBC title defense against one of the pound-for-pound legends at 115 pounds, Sisaket Sor Rungvisai, the two-time former champion in this weight class, and one of the key featured fighters at 115 pounds that has made the division what it is today. That is part of three world title fights here on this main card in San Antonio, and it starts off here on Before the Bell with two very good fights, including the 17-year-old from down the road in Del Rio, Texas. It is Jesus Martinez. Panterita is getting ready to go. He'll make his second pro appearance in as many weeks when he faces Kevin Monroy in a four-round contest. Then it is the return of Nikita Ababi. White Chocolate fights out of Brooklyn, and he will end an eight-month layoff when he takes on the 14-1 Noe Larios Jr. The main card at 8 Eastern on DAZN. It begins with a regional title defense for Ray Savage Ford, who is looking to boost his rankings for a major title fight as he battles the undefeated San Antonio native, Ricky Medina Jr. It is the return of Kaskilla. The undisputed welterweight champ Jessica McCaskill puts her titles on the line as she squares up against the division's top contender out of Mexico, Alma Ibarra. And then in the co-feature, a match that has been months in the making, MJ Akhmadaliyev set to make his third defense of his WBA and IBF super bantamweight titles when he faces the veteran title challenger in Ronnie Rios. And then the main event, the legendary super flyweight Sisaket Sor Rungvisai looks for his third WBC title reign as he faces the hometown champion, the reigning WBC super flyweight champ, Jesse Bam Rodriguez. And Chris Algieri, Austin Ammo Williams, welcome to the set, my friend. How you doing?
I'm doing well. This is my first time speaking in front of the people, and I really want to show y'all how much I know about boxing and help the fans understand what's going on in the ring a lot more.
I hear you. Chris, February 5th, we saw Jesse Bam Rodriguez become victorious on only 6 days' notice against Carlos Quadras. Tonight, perhaps a step up in competition at 115 pounds, and yet he's had the proper 8 weeks to train for a guy who may have a higher caliber in Sor Rungvisai.
Yeah, I'm incredibly impressed with this young man. He took that fight on short notice because he believes in himself. He believes in his skill set. His team believes in him. Now, he's showing it again. Instead of taking maybe a cherry-pick fight where you're going to come down to your hometown, defend your title for the first time, nope, takes another step-up fight against a living legend in
Sisaket.
Sisaket, exactly. I mean, this is just a testament to what this kid really can be in this sport. I think he's got a long career ahead of him.
Yeah, they've rolled out the red carpet for Jesse Bam Rodriguez in terms of coming home. There was the Riverwalk workouts. He gets this night a main event in the brand new Techport Arena. But like you said, no cupcake in his first title defense. Sor Rungvisai is hungry, and he is looking to get back his title here tonight. Let's take a look at the road leading up to Rodriguez Rungvisai. Carlos Quadras was originally supposed to face Sisaket Sor Rungvisai. He's forced to step out due to an illness. And Rodriguez gets the call for a title fight.
Too much too soon for Bam Rodriguez, or right place, right time for this late replacement.
The new WBC Super Flyweight World Champion.
Rungvisai saw Rodriguez take his title shot. He's wanted this fight ever since.
Jesse Bam Rodriguez could emerge as a real star of American boxing.
You are looking at the youngest world champion in boxing.
Sore Rungvisai's fought for this moment.
This is a huge fight in a stacked division.
But when you take a look at the 115-pound division, you see the fearsome four. Chocolatito, Juan Francisco Estrada, Carlos Quadras was in there. Cicic Soar Rungvisai obviously in there as well. The new blood with Jesse Bam Rodriguez. What are some adjustments that he's going to have to make when he steps to the ring tonight against Rungvisai, who is looked at as more of a heavy hitter than the other member of the old guard, Carlos Quadras?
You know, Jesse has to be himself. He's got to go out there, start fast, use his youth, use his speed. Rungvisai has the experience and the power advantage. I mean, he's a power puncher. He wants to set up that big left hand. He's got a right hook, too. So, but Jesse needs to be careful, but he also needs to be aggressive.
And he has that exquisite angling we saw in that third round knockdown that he had over Carlos Quadras, the terrific angle, and then the right hand there. But Ammo, when you are in the ring with someone who is deemed to have superior power, what are you on the lookout for?
What you're on the lookout for is never stand on a guy's perfect range. So Jesse Rodriguez is gonna have to close the distance. He's gonna have to make sure that this guy can't get full extension on his punches. Because when a guy can fully extend his power shots, even if you block those shots, that still can hurt a fighter. That can, you know, destroy your arms, hurt your elbows. As you learn in training, you know, it's good to not always go for the head shots or the body shots. Sometimes you have to punch guys where they're not supposed to be hit. So if you got somebody like Rungvisai who can punch really hard, you have to make sure you cut off his distance to a point where he cannot get his shots off perfectly.
It's going to be really interesting to see what type of adjustments Bam Rodriguez does make after getting in the ring with a bigger Carlos Quadras and having the full time in training camp to prepare for Soar Rungvisai. But leading up to fight night here in San Antonio, it has been a week celebration for Jesse Bam Rodriguez and several other fighters on this card with San Antonio ties. You have the undefeated Ricky Medina Jr., Jesus Martinez, for a time lived here in San Antonio as well. Ronnie Rios has a connection with Bam Rodriguez. There you see Alma Ibarra, who's going to be getting inside the ring with Jessica McCaskill. They did the workouts down the river. Guys, what do you think of this? Do you think it improves agility here? Doing some pad work on the river?
I mean, that's a great way to practice balance. You have unsteady ground underneath you. You got to throw your bunch, throw your combinations. I think that's pretty cool.
Exactly. And not only that, the outside element. There might be bugs out in the water, you know. a mosquito might fly in your face, and you got to stay focused on that pad. So I think that's amazing that they can go out there and still show their skills with all of those different elements going on.
Not to mention the heat. It's been 105-plus all week here in San Antonio.
Yeah, good workout, good stretch down the river. There you see MJ Akhmadaliev opting for the long sleeves, getting a nice burn and a nice sweat going back on Wednesday. And then Cicic Soar Rungvisai taking his river walk boat. And I asked Bam Rodriguez afterward, after he came off the boat, what was the most unique thing that he's seen going down the river being a San Antonio resident. He said, really, just boats, nothing crazy like this. This is probably the most unique, and he was a part of it, and it was fun to watch him going down the river, take that lap around the Riverwalk, and you see the fans chant his name, people yelling out their names, because it is a very localized feeling here in San Antonio. They care and they appreciate their own here in this city. And there you see Jesse Bam Rodriguez. Earlier in the week, he met the mayor of San Antonio. He was delivered a proclamation as well. So Jesse Bam Rodriguez, boxing's youngest champion, making his homecoming fight. And it is so rare that we see a guy win a title and then take on the top contender for that title. The way he explained it, though, remember, February 5th, he stepped in for Soar Rungvisai against Carlos Quadras. Rungvisai fell ill. He felt it was only appropriate and right to give Rungvisai his title shot here in his first title defense.
That is a very honorable young man right there. I got to speak to him at the weigh-in yesterday. I asked him about that. How are you going to go from such a big fight to an even bigger fight? He goes, this is what legends are made of. I want to be a legend in this sport. I need to take fights like this.
That's the greatest thing you said, honor. Honor is a major quality that champions all have. And this guy is willing to give somebody a fight that is not the easiest fight to take, not the road he has to take as a champion. You have options as a champion. So this guy is definitely building his legacy, and that's what you want to see from a young star.
It's going to be interesting to see how that combats perhaps some anger. Rung Vasai, in February, he made a long trip from Thailand only to be shacked up in a hotel the entire fight week and watch Jesse Bam Rodriguez take his title shot and win the title. He's made a long road back to Texas here. It should be fun to see what is in store in this main event between Rodriguez and Rung Vasai. Speaking of what's in store, here's a look ahead at what's on DAZN.
Let's get ready to rumble! Entering the arena, Derek Wachisora!
No, that's cut it clean!
Tuna! Ortiz Jr.
And we are back here on Before the Bell. Justin Shackle, Chris Algieri, Matchroom Chairman Eddie Hearn, ahead of Rodriguez Rung Vasai. Eddie, good to see you back here in San Antonio, right on the heels of the first press conference tour between Canelo and Triple G in Los Angeles yesterday. And here tonight, a terrific event. Three world title fights on the line. How proud are you to just be able to be involved with such like a stacked card, the depth of this event overall? What does it mean to be able to promote three title fights in one show?
This is a real fight fans fight card. You know, I mean, Jesse Rodriguez is a young man that everybody's talking about within boxing. We still need him to cross over to the mainstream audience. It's very difficult to do that as a super flyweight or even a mini flyweight, junior flyweight as he was. But everyone knows how good he is. And he's very young, the youngest world champion in boxing. Murojan Akhmadaliyev, I feel like he's the best 122 pounder in the world. There's the big fight against Stephen Fulton, you know, in terms of unification matchups, undisputed matchups rather. But I love the fight with Ronnie Rios because he's another old school fighter that he's just coming to change his life tonight. And Jessica McCaskill against Ibarra, do not forget about this fight. Remember this when I say this will be an absolute thriller because McCaskill's really improving. She's all action and Ibarra's very well schooled. She's going to have a lot of support in here tonight as a Mexican fighter as well. Even Ray Ford against Medina, really interesting matchup. And beneath that as well, on Before the Bell, Nikita Ababi's got a tough fight in his return. And obviously our young Jesus Martinez, just 17 years of age, making his run in the professional game.
Yeah, Chris and I were talking about Jesus just for 17 years of age. He's a huge boxing fan, appreciates the history of the sport as well. You get to talk in boxing with him, he could go down the rabbit hole here. Taking a look, though, at this main event, we were just discussing the willingness of Jesse.
Oh, unbelievable. Yeah.
Right away, right out of the gate, make that first defense against a guy like Rung Vasai. How noble is that? How rare is that?
Well, I mean, Robert Garcia for a long time has basically told me, look, we've got this kid, Jesse Rodriguez. He'll fight anyone. We started to put him on a few shows and we started to see how good he was. Now, when the Rung Vasai Quadras fight fell through on 1 week's notice, I said to the guys in the office, don't suppose Robert Garcia would take the Quadras fight. And they're like, he's two divisions higher, like, he's very experienced. I said, ask him. And he came back and went, yes. Like, literally,
no,
yes.
No question about that. Yeah. Didn't
this is a different kind of fight to Quadras. No disrespect to Quadras. He is an aged fighter. Like, he doesn't carry huge power, in my opinion, compared to a Rung Vasai. But this is another level. You know, this is a guy who's knocked out Chocolatito. You know, he's been a former multi-time world champion. He's an outstanding fighter. My worry with Jesse Rodriguez is two things. Number one is the size, because Rung Vasai is much bigger in many different ways than Jesse Rodriguez. And my other worry is, I guess confidence is a great thing, but like the overconfidence of just going, I'll fight him, I'll beat him all. It's great to hear from a fighter, but at the same time, as far as they're concerned, it's not this is no risk, but we breeze through Rung Vasai. Like, and Rung Vasai is the kind of opponent that you could get in there after three or four rounds and go, oh, oops, this isn't quite what I was expecting in here. Like, you're talking about a world-class season. At one point, you know, considered for the pound-for-pound list. when he knocked out Chocolatito. So I think it's a really, really tough fight. I do think that Rodriguez could stop Rungvisai late on in the fight because I think his movement's going to cause a lot of problems. But I think the relentless pressure from Rungvisai is going to cause problems for Jesse Rodriguez as well. We saw that in the Estrada fight particularly, where for some reason he kept switching between orthodox and southpaw, which was strange. But what he didn't stop doing was coming forward all night,
yeah,
and took a lot of punishment, but kept coming, and he carries power, and he's always dangerous.
Yeah, he came on very strong at the end of that fight. That's something that Jesse needs to be careful. He needs to stay focused all night long.
That's coming up later tonight here on DAZN, the main card starting up at 8 Eastern. Right now, we are ready to get the matches on before the bell started. For that, we go to the ring with David Diamante.
Welcome to San Antonio, Texas. We are live on DAZN for a big night of World Championship Professional Boxing. We begin tonight with an affair in the bantamweight division set to make his ring walk. Please welcome Kevin Trouble Monroy.
Well, Kevin Monroy is 22 years of age. He fights out of Spring Valley, California. He is 1-2 with a knockout win and a knockout defeat, the latter coming in his most recent match 364 days ago against a promising young Japanese fighter, Subaru Murata. Monroy has now dropped two straight fights, and he is going for his first win since his pro debut back in March of 2021.
And now set to make his ring walk from Del Rio, Texas, please welcome Jesus Panterita Martinez.
Well, Panterita has arrived as a pro here in the U.S. 17-year-old Jesus Martinez made his pro debut just over 2 weeks ago in Guadalajara. He put together a full display of skills over four rounds, and now the 14-time national amateur champ, he is set to make his U.S. debut as a pro. Trained by Robert Garcia, he resides in Del Rio, Texas, a border town about 150 miles or so west of San Antonio, so plenty of family and friends on hand to watch Martinez open the show at Tech Ford Arena. For just a 17-year-old, Martinez has handled early pro life with aplomb. He is looking to live up to the hype and fulfill a dream that he's had from a young age. He said he wants to become a multi-division world champion.
Ladies and gentlemen, once again, good evening and welcome to San Antonio, Texas, USA. We are live on DAZN for a big night of World Championship Professional Boxing. It's all being brought to you courtesy of Mr. Eddie Hearn of Matchroom Boxing. We're sponsored by Bet Online, Hennessy, Never Stop, Never Settle, M150, Basalt, Stagefront, and JD Sports. All of tonight's bouts are sanctioned under the auspices of the Texas Department of Licensing and Registration. The supervisor is Gus Calderon. Introducing your three judges scoring our first contest from ringside. Ruben Carrion, Tim Cheatham, and Steve Morrow. And at the sound of the bell, your third man in the ring, referee Mark Calloy. And now, ladies and gentlemen, four rounds of boxing scheduled in the bantamweight division. Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner, wearing the red, green, and white trunks. He scaled 120.2 pounds. His professional record, one win versus two defeats. He hails from Spring Valley, California. Please welcome Kevin Trouble Monroy. Monroy. And his opponent across the ring, fighting out of the blue corner. He wears the white, silver, and black.
He scaled an even 120 pounds. His young professional record thus far perfect, one fight, one victory. Fighting out of Del Rio, Texas, introducing Jesus Panterita Martinez. Martinez.
Hey, Clement, I am ready to give you instructions in the dressing room. I want a clean fight. Check the gloves and go to your corners. Good luck.
Well, Jesus Martinez scored a unanimous decision victory over Daniel Nunes Gomez in his pro debut just 2 weeks ago in Guadalajara. Kevin Monroy, meanwhile, coming off his second straight defeat nearly a year ago against Subaru Murata. As we get going here on Before the Bell, Kevin Monroy in the white trunks with the Mexican flag colors in the front, and Jesus Martinez in the white trunks with the black trim. Chris, I know you said you were looking forward to watching Jesus Martinez, your first look at him, and when you see a prospect, a much hyped prospect, what are you looking for immediately out of the game?
Well, generally, guys who have such high amateur pedigree of the way that Martinez does, you know, I always look at their eyes. I'm always seeing how much they are aware they are of their opponent, how they're setting things up, how they're using their setups. And right away, I can see that. He's got great balance. His in and out's very good. His hand position's excellent. I like what I see already.
That's a nice straight right hand. One thing I like to see, too, from kids coming out of the amateurs is the ability to make, you know, not a seasoned fighters very uncomfortable, because they can't take a complete amateur approach to these fighters. That won't work for a guy fighting somebody so unorthodox.
You see Martinez with the easy, free-flowing bounce, the comfortable bounce on his feet here in round one right now on the left side of your screen. He talked to him earlier in the week. Martinez kind of gushed about what you just said, Austin, and the fact that in his last fight against Daniel Nunez Gomez, he made it a point. Gomez was 28 years of age. He put him down on the floor. The big punch comes in there. Monroy trying to battle back.
These are the moments that young professionals need. They need to learn how to take a shot. They need to know how to react when there's something happens that they aren't expecting. And we need to see how they're going to perform over the course of the fight. Will they pull back? Will they engage more? These are major things we'll know about them for the rest of their career.
Monroy coming forward and a right counter from Martinez, trying to land another one. Monroy looking for that right uppercut. Good movement on defense for Martinez.
See Monroy fighting out of that southpaw position with his right foot in front. A little bit unorthodox in the way that he throws punches. Seems like it's going to take Martinez a little bit to figure out the rhythm and the timing.
Definitely. Pace is such a big thing, especially with these two guys coming from Texas and California. These are two high-paced states. They teach a high-paced sort of fight. So it's going to be a big deal to control the pace when it comes down to Martinez.
Ooh,
close-range action. I've seen a headbutt. Again, Martinez, just 17 years of age.
And Justin, I think you hit the word right on the head.
Big right hand for Martinez.
Comfortable. Martinez looks very comfortable, even though he has an awkward guy in front of him.
The state of Texas, one of the few in the U.S. that will allow a 17-year-old to fight as a pro if you petition. He began his career, like we said, as the right hand comes in Guadalajara, picked up that first win, and he looks calm and collective here in the opening round against the 22-year-old Monroy.
That was a nice first round. I really think that Martinez needs to pick up the pace. If a guy like Monroy gets comfortable, he can make the fight very ugly and very unorthodox, and that's not something you want as Martinez, because that won't make his performance look as good.
I'd like to see a little more of the lead left hand, the jab from Martinez. When he threw it, he had great success. He just didn't throw a whole lot of jabs. There's a good one right there.
The hybrid uppercut from Kevin Monroy.
Nice overhand.
Yeah, that overhand right was a punch that Martinez perhaps at times tried to kind of force in a couple of weeks ago in Guadalajara. When you talk to him, you can tell he is very mature for a 17-year-old. He put down Nunez in that first round. Like we mentioned, 28 years of age in terms of an opponent, 11-year gap right there. He quickly realized, maybe at the end of the first or second round, that they were going to go the distance. So that's when he kind of backed off a little bit and slowed himself down. There's real poise and Jesus Martinez as we begin round two. There's that overhand right from Jesus Martinez. And a wild left hook by Monroy.
I think Martinez would have more success if he straightens that right hand out. When he throws it over the top, it shortens it up a little bit.
And when you see a fighter throw a lot of overhand shots, they're definitely looking for a shot that will debilitate their opponent. Monroy right now, I believe, is too comfortable and able to think about things, just like that shot he threw right there. That's a straight shot right down the middle. Martinez has to take these things away from this kid. More jabs from Martinez will silence this kid, Monroy. Good hook.
Quick combo leading to the left hook from Martinez. Decorated amateur, fought to 137-9 as an amateur, as he continues to throw the two-handed combo, stiff right hand that lands on Monroy from Martinez.
There's that punch we spoke about, Amo, that straight right hand.
Straight right hand. He's finding the shot, and that will change the fight.
A lot of times when you're fighting an awkward fighter like Monroy, it's better just to keep it simple. The fundamentals always work. There it is.
Another impressive right hand.
Now that he's found that shot, he can build on top of that. And I think him bringing back the left hook will be something that will really hurt this kid, Monroy.
Another chip right hand. He
right on cue.
Cobbled it up with the left hook.
There it is.
The variety of right hands all coming in equally powerful from Jesus Martinez here in the second round.
Monroy is a warrior. This is a great fight for Martinez to have in his second fight. Because this kid is definitely durable, and he's here to fight. He's not here to take a knee. He's not here to, you know, quit and just get out of the ring. So this is actually a great learning experience for Martinez.
Left hook from Martinez. Monroy trying to spoil Pantherita's night in front of his family and friends here in San Antonio.
Nice straight 1-2.
Man, that was a good shot right down the middle. Split the guard of Martinez.
These guys have to definitely watch the headbutts off of one another because, you know, no one's safe from headbutts. A cut from a headbutt can change the tide of any fight. So we have to be comfortable and we have to watch the distance.
The right hand following the jab from Martinez. Monroy standing there. Big overhand left. That lands for Martinez.
This is where Martinez needs to capitalize on top of that. You get a small window to finish, guys. With a shot like that, you have to have the killer instinct to go in.
Beautifully timed check hook there. The left hook, great weapon against the southpaw.
We saw the right hands flowing, but the most impactful punch in that round was the left hand from Jesus Martinez.
As I said before, I really think him putting his shots together will end this fight. That one shot that he hit with that kid with, if he would have ripped back a left hook, that could have been good night.
We see the combination there for Martinez. Right-left-right hand combination, which is a great combo against the southpaw. Landed a good two or three shots there. And then at the end of the round, as Amo was saying, he needed to add that left hook to the straight out of hands, and he did that perfectly toward the end of the round.
I'm really impressed with the Martinez kid. Even though we're not seeing an early knockout, I'm still impressed with him and how he's keeping his poise through everything that's happening. There's been a few headbutts, there's been a few really ugly entanglements, and he's still keeping himself poised and ready to fight.
Martinez looked very calm in between rounds.
Third round underway. This one's scheduled for 4. The second pro fight for Jesus Pantherita Martinez here in San Antonio, a place he calls his second home. Martinez, for a time, lived in San Antonio. Said from age 9 to 14, as a left hand comes in from Pantherita. That's when he met Jesse Bam Rodriguez for the first time. Started training at the Garcia Boxing Academy when it was in San Antonio.
One thing that's lacking all the way around in this fight is body shots, okay? When you have guys that are high paced, taking that energy away from a fighter with the body shots, that can be a fight ender. Most guys get really used to taking shots to the head, especially when they're not as skilled. And when you go downstairs with hard left hooks and straight right hands to the body, that will take the fight to a different stage and let you choke a fighter out.
Monroy starting to be crowded by Martinez in those combos.
Body shots will be essential in this fight. If Martinez wants to really slow Monroy down, he has to go downstairs to the body.
That's a great point, especially because Monroy is really overextending himself at times, throwing those big shots down the middle.
It's something we didn't see 2 weeks ago either. A lot of body work from Jesus Martinez. Overhand right, one of the few that have connected. Martinez really likes that punch.
The body work, that's a nice shot to the body. And I think that's an adjustment that should be made a bit earlier. You just take the steam out of fighters quick, and it starts to show up in the third and fourth round.
And if you notice, right after Martinez landed a good body shot, Monroy threw one shot of his own, so you know that one got through.
Monroy coming forward here, overhand left, over the right hand of Monroy.
Now, retreating with a guy like Monroy is not always the best thing to do, because to make a fighter like Monroy uncomfortable, he needs to go backwards. He needs to go backwards. Right now, Monroy, he's already calculated that he may take big shots, so they won't have as much sting as they would if he was going back and he was completely out of his comfort zone.
Left hook from Martinez as they move back to the center of the ring. Martinez lowering his body before launching that right hand.
Good footwork.
Nice angles there, yeah.
Great angles.
Martinez called his style really unique. And guys, it's something we hear all the time. Hey, I have such a unique style, I can do it all. Martinez, he said earlier this week, yeah, a lot of people say that. I truly believe I displayed my full package and still kept some things under wraps that I'm obviously going to unleash. But he feels comfortable in his ability, and he goes down there. A left hand by Monroy. And that's a knockdown early on at the hands of Kevin Monroy.
Wow, wow, wow.
Looked like a left uppercut, or it might have been a sweeping left shot that Martinez dipped right into. I think he took that on the chin. He got put on his butt.
We're going to learn a lot about Martinez tonight with how he reacts in this last round. All right, he has one round to make that up. Not only that, win the judges back over and, you know, display that he's more than just a skillful boxer, but a fighter as well.
A knockdown in a four-round fight can be disastrous.
Not enough time to make it up.
A massive round about to come up here for Jesus Martinez and Kevin Monroy on Before the Bell. After a 10-8 round three, for Kevin Monroy.
Oh, nice shot. Martinez
was having a good round up until that point. He got caught right at the end.
That's why we cannot get careless. As I seen it back, Martinez overextended on a shot and got caught with a left uppercut.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the fourth and final round.
Maybe a little renewed energy from Kevin Monroy coming out of the corner to start this fourth and final round after picking up that third round knockdown. Let's see how Martinez reacts.
He believes he can hurt the kid. And once you believe and know that you can hurt someone, it definitely changes your demeanor in a fight.
You can see his body language.
Yes, he's going to be a lot more aggressive. He's going to go for the knockout, and that's going to give him a lot more activity, which is so important in a four-round fight. It's just like the amateurs. We're looking for activity. But also, he can make a big mistake and get caught by Rodriguez as well.
The energy
Martinez
so far turned up here in round four. Kevin Monroy entering at 1-2. He's had a sit on two straight defeats for 364 days. His last match, June 26th of last year.
And that's very interesting, because some fighters sitting on losses like that makes them hungrier. It makes them hungry. It makes them want to redeem themselves. So that might be what we're seeing tonight from Monroy.
Monroy looks pretty hungry to me. You mentioned it earlier, Amal. He's here to win. He's not here just to lay down.
Smearing right hand from Martinez, follows it up with an overhand left. Monroy active here in the fourth round as well.
Clash of heads there.
Clash of heads. Very, very, very important to stay away from the clash of heads.
That's one of the biggest transitions coming out of the amateurs to the pro ranks, is the lack of headgear and getting those heads banging together, especially when you're fighting awkward fighters who may not be as experienced as some of the international guys.
Three-punch combo by Martinez moments ago. 90 more seconds in this one.
This is the most important part of the fight. Right here, the last minute and 30 seconds of the last round. Like Chris said, a four-round fight, a knockdown could be disastrous.
Ooh.
So he has to make it very, very clear that he's the better fighter and win this round in flying colors.
I think when Martinez goes back and watches the tape of this fight, he'll see that when he threw the straight punches, just getting to the target, touching his opponent, rather than swinging for the big shots, he was way more effective.
okay, fatigue is setting in now. This is where Martinez's superior training should step up. He should be able to step on the gas at the last minute of the last round.
Monroy slowing down just a bit here over the final minute, allowing Martinez's volume of punches to pick up just a smidge.
Seems like fatigue is setting in for the both of them.
Yes. They both came out guns a-blazing. A right hand lands by Martinez.
He's a warrior. Martinez is definitely a warrior.
Aye.
Trying to turn it on with that left hand over the last 20 seconds of this four-round affair. With family and friends in the stands from nearby Del Rio, Martinez trying to close out strong following his first pro knockdown. That's how it ends. Jesus Martinez bouncing back pretty nicely in that fourth round. But again, guys, just four rounds. Who knows what could be on that judge's scorecard?
Yeah, I think this is going to be a very interesting decision. I still believe Martinez did enough to win the fight, but you never know what the judges saw in there. The last two rounds, Monroy was going forward. A lot of judges like that.
Especially in Texas. Texas is the place of coming forward and fighting.
Great point.
That's something that Martinez should know. Where you fight is very important on the style of fighting that you need to bring.
Yes, I mean, you alluded to that Martinez was giving ground to Monroy, and that was giving Monroy confidence. We saw that in the last two rounds.
That was one of the best things that happened to me coming up in the amateurs in Houston, Texas. It taught me a come-forward fighting style. It taught me how to adjust to what judges want to see. And it's be interesting to see how the judges judge this fight.
Jesus Martinez acknowledging the fans, the friends, the family who made the drive over to San Antonio in support. And Kevin Monroy, man, that knockdown had to feel good. After two straight defeats, a long layoff, trying to get back in the game.
For a fighter like Monroy, a knockdown over a highly touted young prospect is great for his career. This is going to give him the credibility to go in and test fighters. And before you know it, he might get a real shot.
Yeah, win, lose, or draw, promoters will use him to test their young upcoming fighters. So he will have a lot of opportunities in the future.
This was Monroy's fourth straight four-round match to begin his pro career, and it was also his first time fighting in Texas as a pro. Previously fought in Las Vegas, in Long Beach, California, and in Tijuana. So here we go. After four interesting rounds, we get the judges' scorecards, the final decision with David Diamante.
Ladies and gentlemen, after four rounds here at San Antonio, we go to the judges' score totals. Steve Morrow, 38-38 even. Ruben Carrion, 39-36. And David Sutherland, 39-37. Both for your winner by majority decision. He's still undefeated, Jesus Panterita Martinez.
Oh, he's obviously disappointed, Monroy, and I understand, I get it, but, you know, you got to also understand, you know, when you go and you fight a young kid like Martinez coming up, you have to finish the job. You can't just knock him down, you have to knock him out to get a guaranteed win.
Yeah, probably a good lesson for both fighters, obviously very different lessons.
Yeah, absolutely, but I mean, I agree with the scorecards. Like I said, I had Martinez still winning the fight. The majority decision sounds about right to me.
So Jesus Panterita Martinez improves to 2-0, gets two wins out of the gate in his first full month as a pro. His first victory in Guadalajara, his second one here tonight, closer to home in San Antonio. And there, a dejected Kevin Monroy after recording that third round knockdown, putting Martinez on the floor and coming up just short as we welcome you back inside the studio here on Before the Bell, along with Chris Algieri, Austin Ammo Williams. I'm Justin Shackle, following Jesus Martinez. Majority decision victory over Kevin Monroy as we take a look at some of the fight highlights here to start us off at TechPort Arena. What'd you like early on, Chris?
You know, it wasn't the prettiest fight in the world. You know, both guys weren't really using fundamentals, especially early on, but it was an exciting scrap. Monroy was here to win the fight. He wasn't here just to show up. And he tested Martinez in a lot of ways. Martinez had to figure out an awkward style. He had to find what shots were working. He actually had to deal with a knockdown late in the third round and actually pull out the fight, finishing strong in round number four.
Both fighters learned a lot tonight, and both fighters really won tonight. As I said before, Monroy did not lose. He is going to be used by these promoters as a test fight for their young prospects, and that's checks coming in for him.
Okay, he falls to 1-3, but that's a good point. If he came out and didn't look impressive, maybe didn't record a knockdown, who knows what could have been next for him, because a 1-3 record obviously doesn't look good on paper, but people don't need paper in the industry these days. He's going to get more run, like you said, Ammo.
Right. And fighters are going to want to knock Monroy out in comparison to Martinez. They're going to say, if I can knock this kid out and Martinez couldn't, then that makes me a better fighter than him.
All right, coming up next is Nikita Abbabi, but before that, Ammo, it's your commentating debut, but your day job, you're pretty impressive with that as well. You're coming off a victory over Cordell Booker at Madison Square Garden in late April. You pick up your first regional title. Overall, you had a chance to watch that show. What'd you think of your performance? It was pretty quick, but overall, what about the substance involved in it?
I think I did exactly what I needed to do that night by showing that I'm on a completely different level. We took another highly touted prospect who is not somebody who just fought on, you know, unpublicized cards. He fought for PBC. He's had experience as well. He had really great victories as well, and I got to knock him out in the first round. And I just needed an opportunity to solidify that I am potentially one of the greats, and that's what I did that night. Eddie Hearn, he's acknowledged it. Everybody at Matchroom, the powers that be, have acknowledged it. So now we're just looking forward to what's next.
Yeah, I remember leading up to the fight, you were pretty honest. That was the toughest opponent of your career. And Chris, I know you know Cordell Booker as well. You were really impressed with what you saw from this guy standing in the middle.
Absolutely. Like, I've been in the gym with Cordell many times. He's a friend of mine, and I was really impressed with what we were able to do that night, Ammo.
Well, we are joined in studio by Jesus Panterito Martinez. Step closer, my friend. 17 years of age, improving to 2-0. Congratulations. But what did you learn going into that fourth round after being knocked down in the third?
No, I knew it was that round was to him because of the knockdown. And it wasn't nothing, just a little stumble. But fourth round, I knew I had to pick it up, so I give it my all. I showed everyone that I had the dog in me, and I have a super, super, super big heart, so I showed everyone that.
That fourth round, both started off guns a-blazing, but could you sense him slowing down over that final minute?
What was that?
Could you sense him slowing down over that final minute in the fourth round?
Yeah, I mean, we knew he was going to come out guns blazing because of the knockdown, but I wasn't hurt at all. So in a way, it was good that he came at me because there was more openings and everything. So that's why in the fourth round, I closed it out good.
Overall, what did you like about your performance as we look back at some of this footage here?
I like that I could show more boxing and everything. He was a tough guy. He took a lot of the shots, but I showed a lot of heart. I showed my boxing skills and everything, so I liked it.
All right, what did your manager, Darren Barker, have to say to you as you had your hand raised and came out of the ring?
No, he said, well done, mate, and everything, but I'm really happy to have Darren on my side, RGBA on my side, and I'm looking forward to the next one.
Have you met Austin Ammo Williams here?
Yesterday at the hotel, I met Chris Audrey the day before, so they were awesome people.
Chris, you and I were talking about it. We were saying, giving you props, man, 17 years of age, you know your boxing. You know your boxing history. You're just a pure fan. Overall, Chris, what did you like and what do you have to say to Jesus?
You know, I think that you got some really, really great experience tonight. You know, from dealing with a very awkward opponent who came to win. He was not a rollover. He was not the kind of guy who just came here for a paycheck. He came to try and win this fight. You had some opposition. You figured things out. You had to deal with a knockdown in a four-rounder, which can be disastrous. And you still pulled out the victory. So I think it was great experience, and I'm looking forward to the next one.
Thank you so much. I knew with the knockdown and everything, in my heart, I knew I needed to pick it up, but I wasn't too worried because I put in so much hard work. I put in rounds with the world champion who's going to fight today, Jesse Bam Rodriguez. I put in work with the best trainers, and, you know, I knew it was going to pay off.
Congratulations, Jesus. Improving to 2-0. And best of luck to you later this summer.
Thank you so much for calling my fight. Appreciate it.
Jesus Martinez improving to 2-0. More action straight ahead. Let's go back into the ring with David Diamante.
Ladies and gentlemen, our next contest, 8 rounds in the middleweight division. Now entering the arena, please welcome Noe Larios Jr.
Yeah, I heard he did this for a good fight.
Well, there's Noe Larios Jr. He's 25 years of age out of Ramona, California. He enters at 14-1. With 6 knockouts, but for the first time as a pro, he is making this ring walk following a loss. Larios fell to Kima Najarko back in December in Liverpool in a WBA regional title fight. There are always plenty of lessons for a fighter to take with them following defeat, so we're gonna see if those lessons lead to some redemption for Larios as he fights back in his home country tonight.
And now set to make his ring walk, please welcome the undefeated Brooklynite, Nikita White Chocolate Abadi.
Well, the 11-0 Nikita Abadi has been on the Matchroom USA scene from the very beginning, and yet he is still just 23 years of age. His nickname, White Chocolate, given to him at a young age for that rhythm, that smooth movement that he has in the ring while competing in his native Brooklyn, and he is ending an 8-month layoff tonight after fighting just once in 2021. And Abadi said boxing is once again consuming him after he has had to deal with issues outside of the ring. Tonight, he said, get ready for fireworks and excitement here in Texas.
Ladies and gentlemen, from San Antonio, Texas, live on DAZN, we are set to go with our next contest, and it's all being brought to you courtesy of Mr. Eddie Hearn of Matchroom Boxing. We're sponsored by Bet Online, Hennessy, Never Stop, Never Settle, M150, Basalt, Stagefront, and JD Sports. Introducing your 3 judges scoring this contest from ringside, Ruben Carrion, Ellis Johnson, and Ursulo Perez. And at the sound of the bell, your 3rd man in the ring, referee Rafael Ramos. And now, ladies and gentlemen, 8 rounds of boxing scheduled in the middleweight division. Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner, wearing the black trunks with the red trim. He scaled 156.4 pounds. His professional record, 14 wins, 1 defeat. He has 6 wins coming by way of knockout. Fighting out of Ramona, California, here is Noe Larios Jr. Larios Jr. And his opponent across the ring, fighting out of the blue corner. He wears the white trunks with the chocolate trim. He scaled already 156.6 pounds. His professional record, a perfect one. 11 fights, 11 victories, 6 of them coming by way of knockout. Fighting out of the beautiful borough of Brooklyn, New York, here is Nikita White Chocolate Abadi. Abadi.
You guys receive preferred instruction, protect yourself, and obey my command. Good luck.
Just about ready to go here in our 2nd and final bout on Before the Bell between Noe Larios Jr. and Nikita Abadi. White Chocolate in the white trunks with the black trim, and Larios in the all black trunks with the pink writing going down the side, or red velvet rather, going down the side as we begin here.
Nikita started out with 2 sharp jabs. This fight is definitely going to be a battle of the jabs as they both are rangy. I want to see what Lopez does with his jab tonight.
Nikita Abadi, part of that famed Sosa crew in Brooklyn, growing up over in Brighton Beach, fighting with the likes of Richardson Hitchens and Rashad Mahdi, Chris Colbert, trying to put it together here and continue his boxing career, again entering at 11-0. And he wants to stay active after this fight. He's targeting another fight date in August.
I know Nikita's been out of the ring for several months, and it's been a bit of a layoff, but I know he's been in the gym, he's been working on things, and you can tell by his body, this is the best physical shape that I've seen him so far in the pros.
And he is so experienced as an amateur. And as honestly, these types of fights are where those experiences, when it comes down to being highly skilled, pay off. You have guys that are tough, durable, and can fight. And those little slight edges you have of being a champion and already fighting at the high level as an amateur, this is where it shines through.
Both fighters standing at 6 feet tall even. No, Hilarios had to deal with a shorter Kima Najarko back in December. Came forward, was pretty durable. He knew he was losing over the course of those first 8 rounds against Najarko. Went for it a little bit in round 9, and that's when Najarko was able to catch him with a left hand, and the match ended there. The right hand gets in from a Bobby.
Right hand.
Bobby has great hand speed. Quick jabs, good counters, and watch out for that left hook to the liver.
Big body puncher. Lopez cannot allow Nikita to get comfortable, and same vice versa. No, just like we said before in the last fight, we're in Texas. They're going to look for activity. That's a major part of the scoring process. So these guys are taking it really slow in this first round. And they have to remember, it's only an 8-round fight. It's still not a 10 or 12. So every second counts. Great left hook by Nikita Bobby.
Tries to come in
there.
Back for that right hand. Amil Williams, of course, grew up in Houston. He knows all about the Texas fight game and how everything is measured and scored here in the Lone Star State. Nikita Bobby and Noe Hilarios Jr. in a very much feel out first round.
I like the fact that Nikita is controlling the center of the ring with the taller man. It's a very smart strategy.
Very smart strategy. Very smart strategy to negate a guy like Lopez from engaging. This gives Nikita a great chance to set up counter shots. As we've seen, there was a couple big counter straight right hands that Nikita landed in that round.
Very sharp round for Nikita.
After a long layoff that he's had, this is a great sort of round to shake those nerves. And I think now we're going to see him get a lot more comfortable in this fight.
Didn't look like he had any ring rust to me.
But Bobby said he had to take care of some mental and personal distractions. And he believes that, especially for boxing, you have to be mentally right in your head. You can't worry about anything else. He told me that you can't let anything shake up the structure of your training sessions, your diet, your meal plans. And he said that he just had a lot of distractions and that his brain was everywhere. But he said he is a lot better now. He's only worried about boxing. Had a chance to live and train with Ryan Garcia, work under Joe Goosen earlier this year in preparation for his return and his 2022 debut as we begin round 2 here on Before the Bell of Bobby and Larios. White chocolate in the appropriate trunks.
That's a very smart thing for Nikita to say, having to get himself together outside of the ring before he came back into the ring, because one slip up in this sport is unforgiving. And also, to perform well, you have to be in a great state. So that's very mature of him.
He said exactly that. For a sport where one loss, one off night can wipe away everything that you tried to build up prior to that, you need to be in the right frame of mind. And he also mentioned he started working with a guy like Ryan Garcia because he wanted to associate himself with lions again. He knows that he is one of those lions, and he just needed that reaffirmation. He works quickly here with that lead left going upstairs and downstairs.
I'm very happy to see him go downstairs. It's the same thing we talked about in the last fight. If you want to slow a guy down like Lopez, you have to invest in the body early.
Good counter overhand right from a Bobby.
Nikita is doing a great job of negating the height and reach advantage of Larios. He's pulling it back just at the right times. He's touching the body. He's changing levels. Excellent rhythm so far.
It looks like Lopez just found Nikita with his first jab.
Oh, Larius, I'm sorry. It looks like he's found him with his first jab, and we'll see how he builds on the top of that.
A three-punch combo from Bobby. Lightning quick. Larius tries to answer. The arm length evident when you take a look at the frame of Noe Larius Jr. Again, 14-1 with six knockouts coming off his first pro defeat. Lightning quick right hand lands by Abadi.
Beautiful straight right hand by Abadi. And again, when he starts finding shots like that, to come back with a left hook will be devastating for Larius.
Another right hand.
Good shot.
Nikita utilizing his speed very, very well tonight. He's not working too hard. He's setting up his shots, picking them perfectly, and landing them clean.
Larius trying to come inside with that combo.
It's a lot more action in this second round than there was in the first. I think we're going to see that ramp up over the course of the fight.
I agree. You can tell Nikita's building. He's building on what he did in round number one.
This is round number two, scheduled 8-round fight.
And we can't get careless. Neither one of these fighters can get careless because they both carry knockout punch power. And in the middleweight division, you have the speed and the power. So it's going to be very important that they stay calculated and not get overexcited for any shots. Nikita is measuring them out with the left jab.
Speed on display in round two by Nikita Abadi.
I got Nikita up 2-0 right now. I think if he continues to build off what he's doing, he can take this fight home pretty easy. I want to see how Larius responds in his third round after taking his first real shots from Abadi.
I like the punch variation, the punch selection by Nikita so far. He's picking his spots very well. He's working on that right hand over the top. Not normally a punch I'm used to seeing him utilize a lot, but it's been working really well tonight, which is a great weapon against a small guy like Larius.
Nikita's already up off the stool. That's a great sign as far as conditioning.
Round three underway between Abadi and Noe Larius Jr. You talk about the conditioning of Abadi. There's a reason for that. He was touching on the camps that he was in with Garcia as he comes forward with a left hand there and just working under Joe Goosen. These are 4 or 5 hour days with Joe Goosen and the conditioning that they went through. Left hand to the body by Larius. He tries to fight back here.
I think a lot of it, though, is this newfound pace that Nikita is using. I think he's worked too hard sometimes in past fights. Now he's really settled in. He looks like a real pro, picking his spots and using that speed to be explosive and effective.
You're seeing Nikita start the round off with a few explosive shots. Normally for a fighter, that's testing the other fighter to see where their headspace is. What are you going to do when you know that I'm now going for the knockout? When you know now, I feel like I have you measured out to where I'm going to catch you with one of these big shots. So it's very important to how Larius reacts to the shots that were just thrown by Nikita.
Both men working in the center of the ring. Abadi controlling the pace so far. Fell into a great pace in his victory back in October in Fresno against Sonny Duverson. This is a different looking, more energetic, close range uppercut.
Good uppercut on the inside from Larius. Could have been a little bit late depending on, you want to think the ref was breaking them.
Now this is where we cannot get out of control. As I said before, both fighters have the ability to knock someone out. You can't get overconfident or overcomfortable. You have to stay very poised and look for the shots that are going to do damage.
Larius landed more punches in the last 30 seconds than he has up until this point in the fight.
Yes.
Turning up the tempo in round three. Abadi looking for answers. Gets a good left body hand shot buried into the body.
Body shot. And as I talked about before at the beginning of the round, mental warfare. This round is about mental warfare. Nikita came out to show Larius that he was going for the knockout, and now that Larius is still coming forward, now it is a mental battle between Abadi and Larius.
Now the fight begins.
Now the fight begins. You normally can take a fighter's heart when you show them that you're going to knock them out.
Bobby keeping Larios at a distance here in round three.
This is where we're going to see what the camps were like, who's really conditioned, who has the mental strength, and who is the most disciplined.
About a 12-second differential between the round clock and what was displayed there. Left hand cracks Larios.
Nice.
You can tell Larios is building in confidence.
Good definitely. Back and forth action in round three, but that was obviously the best round by Larios of the fight.
To start off a round coming forward, throwing hard shots, and to end the round going backwards and letting the guy throw more shots than you is not a good look in Texas. Nikita must remember, it's very important to finish rounds as similar as you started the round.
Yeah, definitely a shift in momentum in that round. Larios fighting his way back into the fight. Not sure he won that round, but he definitely landed the best punches of the fight so far. It all started with that uppercut on the inside that he landed, popped Nikita's head up. He landed a few more right hands after that, but I believe Nikita took back control later on in the round.
I do like the aggression from Larios with that close range uppercut. Maybe a little late, maybe not. Who knows? Protect yourself at all times.
Protect yourself at all times.
Well, the ref didn't say anything, so.
Let's see how this round starts.
Here we go, round four. Nikita Ababi, the white trunks with the chocolate dripping at the waist. And Noe Larios trying to bounce back from his first pro defeat. He enters at 14-1. Ababi, an undefeated 11-0.
I believe that this is a pivotal round. If Nikita can come out and bring back the dominance he had in rounds one and two, I think he'll have an easier night. But if he lets Larios back into this fight, we could be go in a scrap until the eighth round.
Looks like Larios is targeting the body. That must have been an adjustment his corner decided to make. It's going to be very tough for him to get clean headshots on Nikita, somebody who's so seasoned. So the body shots are the best way to go. Long looping left hands like that are not the best thing to do against a guy like Larios.
Also good to touch body when you have someone who's as quick-handed as Nikita Ababi. Those guys generally spend a lot of energy, so you want to hit him in the breadbasket, get some of that juice down.
Okay, they're both sharing the middle of the ring right now, so we're definitely at a common ground here in this fight. The momentum is anybody's for the taking.
Round four of eight. Ababi slips for a moment. Larios takes advantage, moving inside.
We cannot get overexcited for shots. The jab is lacking for both. We need to pick up the jabs to find the proper shots. There's not many one-twos being thrown in this fight. That's a very essential tool for boxers to have.
Larios coming inside. He's met with a two-punch combo from Ababi.
Yeah, it almost seems like they're going tick for tat now.
Yep.
Back and forth, big shots.
And when things are so closely, when the competition is so close like this, you have to be the person coming forward, pushing the pressure, and landing the more significant shots in Texas. That's very important in Texas.
I love how you keep bringing that up because it is so true, and I'm curious from both of you, how often, Chris, did you go into different settings, different states, various commissions, and AMMO, your current career? How often is that at the top or near the top of your mind where you're fighting and what these different commissions in each state look for?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you also, so in big title fights, you know who the judges are in advance, and you know what they're looking for based on their past experiences and fights. So you always kind of look into that to make sure that you're being a true professional and know every aspect of the game, because when it comes down to fight night, you don't want anything to go awry. Oh, big right hand.
Big punch there here in round four. Larios capping off with the right uppercut.
Larios is getting comfortable. Now, with a fighter like Larios, very, very conditioned, and not only that, very durable, you don't want a fighter like him to get comfortable.
Ababi dropping his hands here in the latter stages of round four.
There can be no lapses in fundamentals right now.
He was caught with a left hand moments ago by Larios, and that's two crisp rounds for the Escondido, California native.
When shots are that clear that the crowd react to it, that's a bad sign. The reason why is because that can sway judges. For Larios, it's an amazing sign, but for Nikita, it's not that great of a sign. That can easily sway judges' decision and who they give the round to, especially in a closely competitive round like that.
I gave that round to Larios. I think those shots were strong enough, they were clean enough, and there was enough of them that he could take the round. Larios is very much in this fight.
Larios is definitely in this fight, but one thing I do love that I see is Nikita is still very poised and very calm in this corner.
Absolutely.
Seems like Larios is very, very focused.
Round 5 set to begin in this scheduled 8-rounder here on Before the Bell. Nikita Abbabi on the left side of your screen in the white trunks. Noe Larios Jr. in the black trunks, trying to rebound from his first career defeat and hand Abbabi his first career loss.
Larios made his way to the middle of the round, the center of the ring, and he's taken that position. That's very, very strong signs from a guy like Larios. He's showing that he's here to fight. He's not retreating at all, and the judges definitely see that.
I believe the second half of this fight could be very interesting.
Nikita using his jab, range finding. Good. 1-2.
Back to the fundamentals. I think I like this pace better for Nikita. He's able to control using the jab. He got away from that for the last two rounds.
Jab to the body. That's what we talked about at the beginning of the fight.
Comes back with the right hand following that jab.
The straight long shots are going to be very important for two rangy fighters. So the variety that Abbabi is showing with his left hand is very important.
We see it going upstairs and downstairs here around 5. Big left hook from Larios lands.
Larios needs to pick up the activity. At the end of the day, he is still coming in on a B-side. Mm. He has to be very, very convincing to win this fight.
Good chopping right hand there from Abbabi as Larios came in.
Chris, I know you've been around Abbabi in the New York City fight scene. We've sometimes seen him at his best when he's going to the body more often. Do you want to see him pick up that tempo downstairs?
Yeah, I did mention that earlier. You know, I think his best fight in his arsenal is that punch right there, the left hook to the body. I've seen it in the gym. I've seen it in his early fights. A lot of his stoppages have actually come from body shots. So I would like to see that weapon more often tonight.
And he mentioned how he sparred you.
Yeah. I've sparred Nikita several times. He's been in camp with myself and Daniel Jacobs. He's a very, very talented young man. And that's another thing with someone like him. Even though he has so much amateur experience, he's got a ton of gym experience as well, sparring with the likes of many world champions.
One thing that I'm not seeing a lot of is close quarter inside.
Oh, fight. Big right hand lands by Larios. And he goes back downstairs with the left.
Absolutely, Ammo. It's a lot of long distance and middle distance fighting. Ooh, big right hand from Larios.
These are the segments of time that give a fight, give the edge to either fighter. And these moments on the inside, especially in Texas, they want to see you fight and land clean, effective shots on the inside as well.
A double left hook landing moments ago from Noe Larios Jr.
Last answer.
He is putting together solid rounds in the middle portion of this fight. Right hand landing from Abbabi. And again, Larios with his third straight strong round.
What did you feel about that round, Chris?
I thought it was a strong finish to the round by Larios, but I believe that Nikita was in control for the majority of the round leading up to that point. He finished strong with a big right hand as well. Here we see the right hands over the top, the 1-2. Nikita was doing very well at that middle distance range, using his jab early in the round. There we see him reaching for the body, landing some good overhand rights. But at the end of the round, Larios, as he's been doing the last several rounds, putting a lot of pressure in the last 30 seconds of a round, trying to steal it.
Last three rounds of this fight, very, very important. I think the person who realizes that they should get on the inside and take advantage of that portion of the fight will be the one who comes out victorious tonight.
I agree, Emma. I would love to see some sustained inside work from both these guys.
Here we go with round 6, scheduled for 8 between Abbabi and Larios.
Larios again coming out with a very strong demeanor. He's still here to fight. He's still looking for the big shots. Nikita should
fight a little bit more on the front foot. Again, as I keep going back to, we are in Texas. This is a firefight state. You must show the crowd and the judges that you are here to be the force in the ring.
Nikita Abbabi promised fireworks. Perhaps we see them over the last two rounds and change. This eight-rounder.
See, these moments here, when you learn how to create space, you learn how to pivot, you learn how to find shots on the inside, that's very important, not only for the judging, but breaking a fighter down. That opportunity you have right there is a lot of body shots and uppercuts.
Larios parrying the jab from Abbabi moments ago, trying to move cleanly, using his reach advantage there with that long looping left.
Looks like Nikita's trying to get creative now, trying to open up some different kinds of punches.
Not much steam on that left hook, but a very beautiful punch to throw. Now Larios is going downstairs. I think he has the right idea. Triple jab from Nikita Abbabi.
Ending with the solar plex to Larios. Overhand right by Larios.
I think that was a great attempt, but the lack of footwork.
No. Hey.
That moment right there, that's essential for fights, especially championship-level fights. You can sneak in a couple body shots in a moment like that, and those tiny body shots cause major differences down the stretch.
Absolutely. That's a great point, Ammo. There's a lot of more work that can be done on the inside in the pros than in the amateurs.
Good right hand from Abbabi. Timed it up nicely with Larios encroaching.
Body shots.
Nikita doing a good job of pot-shotting this round, staying on the outside, picking his spots well.
A punch that's lacking in this fight is the uppercut. You get guys that's used to fighting on range a lot, a sneaky uppercut is a game changer. That's a shot that normally the long fighters don't see, and that can end the fight quickly. Three-punch combination from Nikita Abbabi.
Proving to be the more accurate puncher here in round six.
It looks like a lull in action in this sixth round. A couple of great exchanges, but not many. I think they're both trying to figure out what they're going to do to end the fight.
Left hook from Larios. The rounds that could swing in a fighter's favor. And again, accuracy on tap by Nikita Abbabi. See Matchroom Chairman Eddie Hearn. Abbabi is one of the first boxers that Hearn signed when Matchroom arrived here in the U.S.
You know, in that round, Nikita, almost as if he feels that this fight could potentially go the distance, changed up. He started to took some of the power off his punches, used his hand speed, used his fighting, his ability to fight at a distance that round, moving on his back foot, hot shotting, and in my sense, won that round.
Coming up as a young prospect that, you know, I am, these fights are important because you have to not only beat these guys, you have to make a major statement in these fights. I think Nikita has these last two rounds to make a huge statement. It's very important for him to make a statement tonight to move forward in his career.
Ammo, you could be humble about yourself. I'm not calling you a young prospect anymore.
You have entered contender status.
You are high risk, low reward these days.
Thank you.
Start of round seven between Abbabi and Larios.
This is where hunger and attrition comes through. This is where you see with how much a fighter wants it, how bad a fighter wants it. We're in the seventh round of an eight-round fight. We know that the fight is coming to a close. There's no reason to hold back any energy. You must use everything that you've done, all of the conditioning you did in your camp to shine through right now.
Well, you mentioned it. This is where we get to see what was done in camp.
Good left hook.
What's the difference, though, between emptying the tank and doing it without any recklessness?
The difference is the way that you engage, okay? Bobby having some fun in there. The way that you approach this fighter should be a lot more pressure-based rather than point scoring-based, because the pop shots and the point scoring is not going to give you an outstanding performance right now. It's more of a survival sort of instinct to pop shot and to stay away. You want to get inside and take the fight 100%. You definitely don't want to lose your fundamental, you know, mindset at all, though.
Good uppercut attempt there from Larios.
That's the punch we have not seen too much of in this scheduled eight rounder.
Very tit for tat right now.
Good right hands landing from Abadi.
Smart punching by Abadi.
And scoring points here in round seven. Larios trying to get inside, work the body, landed a right, then a left.
At this range and pace, I find it very difficult for Larios to win rounds.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Abadi's showing his hand speed, he's looking flashy. Not doing much damage, but he's definitely controlling the pace.
Yes. That brought me back to what you said in between the last round. Abadi took some steam off of his shots, but he's landing the shots clean. That's very important when you come down to a decision.
Oh,
nice shot.
Right hand there. And a left hook back from Nikita.
Nice left hook.
Abadi coming in with a 1-2 combo.
It seems like the referee is now not engaging as much to give them the opportunity to take the fight on the inside. Good left hook by Nikita Abadi in a straight right hand and another left hook.
Oh, coming upstairs from Larios. Good exchanges here over the final minute of round seven.
I think Abadi definitely take this round.
Split the guard with that right-handed Larios.
Larios tends to come on strong the last 30 seconds of every round.
Nice uppercut from the right side by Larios. He's met with a right counter from Nikita Abadi.
I'm not going to lie, I don't mind when they exchange. It makes it a lot more entertaining.
Right. This is what the people want to see, especially in Texas. Body shots.
Solid round of point scoring for Nikita Abadi in the seventh round.
As I said before, these fights are so important for prospects. You have to have crowd-shifting performances at this moment. You have to have that. You cannot have the crowd disengaged. Everybody's looking. Everybody's trying to see and measure what you can be in front of a huge crowd.
Yeah, Nikita did a good job in that round, flashing his hand speed, his head speed, moving that upper body very well. Now, caught a few shots, but landed some really good shots of his own.
Now this is the time to empty the tank.
Final 3 minutes about to commence between Nikita Abadi and Noe Larios Jr.
I believe Nikita wins this fight easily on the scorecard.
He's landed the more consistent heavy shots. He's got the eye-catching shots. He's controlled much more of the pace of the fight. I agree.
Here we go with round number eight. Abadi and Larios.
And now that we're in that mindset, this lets me know that Larios' corner should be telling him to go for broke right now, because they know that he's not ahead on the scorecards. The only chance that he has at winning this fight is a knockout. So Abadi needs to be very technical, and he needs to understand that he's ahead on the scorecards and, you know, kind of cruise to the finish in my mind.
Abadi beginning this fight, looking very energetic, calm on his feet. Larios in the middle rounds, gaining some steam, but here Abadi reeling in the momentum and the pace of this eight rounder.
Good body shot.
Coming with that left hand.
The left hook by Larios.
Larios has been able to land some heavy shots, so as long as this fight's on, he still has a chance.
The Abadi jab finding a home here in the eighth round.
Moments like that, that little tie-up we just seen, uppercuts are so important. That's a blind shot that can really destroy a fighter quickly.
It's 1-2-1 there from Nikita.
Larios eats the left hand at the end. Here he's dishing some out.
He's definitely aware that he has to go for damaging sort of shots, Larios. So Nikita needs to stay aware, need to see every shot. And he can't have one mental lapse in there.
90 seconds remain. Larios trying to avoid two straight defeats after beginning his pro career at 14-0. Abadi trying to stay undefeated.
Good timing.
Good connection from Larios. Left hand to the body from Abadi.
Oh, another nice uppercut.
Big overhand right, counter right from Abadi.
Larios is definitely going for it here.
Yeah, he's bringing it. Putting a lot of pressure on Nikita.
Final 60. Abadi with the combo. And a good right hand from Abadi as Larios comes in and is going to let the hands go.
Larios is smart. I must give it to him. He's the one that's doing the thing that the judges want to see more, I believe, in this last round. But I still have Abadi far enough ahead on the cards that it won't matter if it goes to
good work from Larios.
Nice.
Abadi answering back. Larios trying to empty the tank, as Emma Williams said. Thinking the side of the cross. Great exchange in the center of the ring. And Larios digging deep to the body. These two fighters mirroring one another over the final 10. Abadi gets snapped back from a right hand.
Oh, nice. Great fight.
Exhilarating eighth round to end it.
Great finish to that fight. Exciting exchanges.
Tough to score.
Yeah. I mean, I think Nikita had done enough, especially in those early rounds, but Larios did not make it easy.
I think Nikita did more than enough, but I think both of these fighters need to understand the importance of the inside game. This is professional fighting here. And I think they could take a lot more from fighters if they truly, truly take advantage of those moments inside.
This could have been a good test here for Nikita Abadi. He may come out victorious here, but there were a lot of close rounds in this contest.
A lot of heated exchanges. Abadi had some in his defense and concentration, got caught in some of those, the end of some of those rounds. But he's been out of the ring for a while now, and this is a good comeback fight against a stiff competition. So,
Larios and Abadi finishing us up here on Before the Bell ahead of Rodriguez, Rungvisai in San Antonio. And early on, I know we enjoyed the rhythm and the speed we saw from Abadi. That really stood out in the early rounds.
I think that's the deciding factor of this fight. The fact that Nikita got a lot of clean, undeniable shots in. He drew the power back to make it through the fight, but he did land the shots that were clean boxing.
And that uppercut kind of opened the door for Larios to gain some momentum in the middle rounds of this contest. And he started and then ended a lot of the middle rounds with some serious momentum that could influence the judges here.
Absolutely.
Like Emma was saying.
And also, like we said before with Monroy, this is not a loss for Larios. This is not a loss for him at all. He will definitely be used to test young prospects coming forward.
Then in the latter rounds, just felt like Abadi regained some rhythm and control over this fight. We'll see on the judges' scorecards. Here is David Diamante.
Ladies and gentlemen, after eight rounds here in San Antonio, we'll go to the judges' scorecards. Ursulo Perez, Ellis Johnson, and Ruben Carrion all scored this bout identically, 78-74. For your winner, by unanimous decision, he's still undefeated, Nikita White Chocolate Abadi.
The Nikita Abadi improving to 12-0. White Chocolate getting the victory after an 8-month layoff. He comes to San Antonio and picks up a unanimous decision victory over Noe Larios Jr. 78-74 across the judges' scorecards. What do you guys think?
That sounded about right to me. You know, like we spoke about it, I had Nikita ahead based on his ability to fight at the middle distance and the outside, his hand speed, and those eye-catching shots. But Larios was very much in the fight, took a lot of those middle rounds, was finishing strong during rounds, so that score sounds about right to me.
Yeah, and I completely agree with the scorecards. I think Larios had the opportunity to end the fight. He had segments of time where he could have ended the fight to win that way, but on the scorecards, I don't think he had a chance of winning.
So Abadi improves to 12-0 as we are close to wrapping up here on Before the Bell ahead of Rodriguez Rungvisai, but we're joined by Mikey Garcia. He comes into the studio. Mikey, good to see you.
Thank you. Welcome. Thanks for having me. Always a pleasure working with everyone.
Coming up tonight on DAZN, again, Rodriguez Rungvisai. Jesse Rodriguez obviously training under Robert Garcia. Sure, you've seen a lot of this stable with Robert. Overall, what are your impressions of Jesse Bam Rodriguez?
Look, we've been very impressed with Jesse. We've seen him develop over the last few years. And even though he's very young, he's got a very seasoned mentality, very seasoned approach, like a veteran. He studies his opponents very well. He takes his time, but he executes. He doesn't waste punches. He has very great footwork, which was most impressive. And just the way he handles everything in the ring, you know, he pays attention to my brother, and he wants to execute, like I said, with precision. So that's very impressive for a kid so young and with such little amount of experience. You know, he's doing the things that a seasoned fighter does.
Coming up immediately on this main card, you have Ray Ford and Ricky Medina.
Yeah.
Medina's undefeated. He sparred with Bam. He's trained with Bam. And you have terrific matches throughout. Obviously, the three title fights, MJ Akhmadaliyev coming up, Jessica McCaskill. But overall, when you examine this main event, Bam Rodriguez, Rung Basai, obviously a veteran of the game, a former champion.
Sure.
How do you see this main event playing out?
Well, again, you know, you got youth against the experience, the seasoned veteran in Rung Basai. Former world champion, solid, solid fighter. Dangerous fighter with all those knockout, you know, victories. So that's what's, you know, the threat. That we got a young kid in Rodriguez, but we have to overcome that experience with skill, with intelligence, good footwork, with speed, you know, and just beat him to that. We can't sleep on Rubenside. Rubenside, like I said, very experienced, very solid, strong fighter. We got to be aware of everything. But I think Jesse's footwork and youth will help him carry on.
Have you seen Jesse today?
I saw him earlier today. You know, just wish him well. Listen to your corner. Have fun. You know, do what you do best, and that's that. Have fun in it.
You mentioned how dangerous Rung Basai is, and we have off-air were speaking about how confident and
sure.
comfortable that Jesse is. When does that become a detriment, and how do you, as a coach and as a team member, how do you keep that in check?
Well, you know, it's good to have the confidence. You want your fighter to be confident, you know, and happy, excited for the fight. But we can be overconfident. We got to remind him to not sleep on Rung Basai, to be aware. Don't take things easy. Don't feel like it's a walk in the park. You know, we got to remind him that. And that's what my brother will do, you know, in the ring, in the corner, and throughout all fight week. My Pupita has been telling him, we've been telling him, you know, as a fighter, I've been telling him myself, you have to be aware. It's good to be confident. I love the energy, but don't forget, you know, you're going into against a former world champion with power, you know, so that's always dangerous. Keep that in mind. So just be yourself. Don't try to change who you are.
I love what you said. Have fun in there. That's a big part, too.
We'll see Jesse Bam Rodriguez coming up. Again, a hometown fight, a homecoming of sorts, but no walk in the park. Something very different for a fighter who takes a title.
Yeah.
Just had to make his first defense. A very stiff test in front of Jesse Bam Rodriguez here tonight. Mike, thanks for stopping by. Good to see
you. Thank you. Appreciate you guys.
Amo, did you have fun?
I had a great time. First time out, I got the comment. And not only that, I got to learn a lot about fighting itself, how things look from the outside. I think that gives me a broader perspective as a fighter, and that helps me move forward as I step into the next level of my career.
Love to hear it. You're terrific. Join us anytime, man. Jesse Rodriguez, Seasaket Sor Rung Basai coming up. A loaded card ahead of that main event. That is going to do it for us here on Before the Bell. For Mikey Garcia, Chris Algieri, Austin Amo Williams, I'm Justin Shackle. Thanks again for joining us, and enjoy Rodriguez Rung Basai on DAZN.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome. It's now time for the featured bout of the evening. From the four corners of the world, to the four corners of this ring, the fight starts now!